The Ryen Russillo Show, post-show podcast.
159, I can ball.
Where's Dreamsicle or whatever you call it?
Midwest Michelle, you make my heart beat faster.
The post-show pod is on.
Episode 7 of the post-show pod, and we're going to react fully to the SVP Russillo Chris Long show from yesterday, Wednesday. I am here, Tommy FreezePops, with Michelle Smallmon, Steve Ceruti.
What's
good, up, guys? Hey. So this is where I want to start. Everyone thought I was going to fangirl over Chris Long with the Patriots thing.
Fangirl, huh?
And Michelle...
Why does that have to be a girl, dude? It's 2017.
Michelle ended up being the one that was fangirling the most. So I just want to put that out there to start.
Yeah, let's...
Everyone thought Tom was going to be like, oh, Tom Brady, tell me Brady stories. Oh, Belichick. I stayed profesh.
That's an excellent point.
Two things here.
Okay.
Number one, you stayed profesh because you were warned by a lot of people not
warned.
Or like
I was scorned is more like it by you and you.
Because if we warned you, you would have still done it.
Yeah, after we had David Ross in here and you screamed at him, let's go Sox, or who was the other one, Teddy Bruschi.
That was like, nice. Just as they're walking away, just down the hall, like, oh, let's go Sox.
Yeah, I don't think that's professional.
Okay. All right. Well, then what?
Would you have done it with if our bosses were in the room?
Yeah, probably.
He definitely would.
Probably not a great move.
Probably.
Okay. Okay. So you would have done it had we not mentioned it prior. Number two, I did not fangirl over Chris Long. I was in the hallway and Ryen called me into his office and Chris said, I really miss St. Louis. And I said, oh my God, me too. And then Ryen was like, I'm going to leave you two alone. And we ended up talking St. Louis dive bars for like an hour.
So Rudy?
Yeah, we were sitting in the studio and I mean, you know, we're taping the Pulse, we're taping all this other stuff. We're talking to TV because like there was a weird day and there was a lot of stuff that they didn't really know about.
Just chatting with Scott, too.
And I like looked up at the clock and I'm like, Michelle's been gone for like an
legitimately hour. In an hour. Did not know
like
where she
12:30.
Went.
12:30. Like, what is going on?
Yeah.
And you're like, yeah, I don't know. It's just because Ryen was around, Scott was around. And it was very strange.
Hadn't seen you.
Ryen will have my back on this one because he even came in twice to say, no, stay here because he wanted Chris's reaction to the Pulse live.
Okay. All I'm saying.
And also in my defense, we did not only talk about St. Louis. We didn't talk about St.
Well,
Louis.
Well, none of us
time.
Know because you were in the office. You could have been fangirling.
No, we kicked around. I helped him with the questions that he had, the reporter style questions for Scott and Ryen. So we kicked all of that around. Mm. We talked hard outs. I mean, I was getting him set formatically,
right.
You guys. Okay.
I mean, it's not like that could have not happened with us in the room.
How many times did Stan Kroenke come up?
Only once.
Ah.
Only once. But
I just wanted to state for the record, I didn't even get to ask him a single Patriots question.
But I will say this.
Day.
I will say this. Ryen did bring up in his office when it was the three of us that you were a huge Patriots fan and probably were like chomping at the bit. Isn't it chomping at the bit?
Chomping.
No, I think it's
definitely chomping.
Chomping at the bit.
I truly think it's like chomping at the bit.
Okay, we'll
and
throw
everyone
it on
says
the poll.
Chomping.
Incorrect. We'll throw it on the poll.
You are wrong.
Maybe.
I think I'm right, you guys. I think it's chomping and not chomping.
Well, that's why I got
I don't
my
even
phone
know what
here. You
means.
Guys carry on.
Yeah. Me either, but someone... anyway, so... really weird side note that we just went on there. But Ryen had said to him, Tommy FreezePops, huge Patriots fan.
Right.
He's probably dying to get at you.
Yeah.
And Chris turns to me and he goes, he knows I was only on the team 1 year, right?
Super Bowl year. And he played fantastic in the Super Bowl. I wanted to congratulate him on a great Super Bowl. And I didn't even do that, which I kind of feel bad about. It's almost like mean on my part that I didn't do that.
Tweet at him, dude.
Yeah, I will. I will send him a nice tweet like, hey, I just thought you had a great Super Bowl. Or maybe I can give Ryen a message, a note.
A handwritten note?
Yes, a handwritten note.
That's a little fatal attraction like Bunny in the Pottish.
So, Rudy, do you have any more evidence to either support or not support Smallmon's claim about Chomp at the Bit?
It might be both.
Oh!
What is Chomp at the Bit?
I don't know what it is, but I'm almost positive that I said chomp at the bit once and someone said, it's champing at the bit, actually.
Who said that?
Yeah. I don't know. Someone corrected me.
Some loser.
Usually written as chomping at the bit, and some people consider this spelling wrong, but chomp can also mean to bite you, blah, 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 noisily. In fact, chomping and this, blah, blah, blah. Where's the second part? Example. Both forms are easy to find in public in edited publications and blogs throughout the English-speaking world.
I will say, for the record, I have never seen champ at
Neither
the bit.
Neither have I.
So...
But
that definition is
overrated.
But I was not incorrect.
Okay, I'll give it to you.
Thank you.
I'll give it to you. But you were still, I still question what was going on. A lot of Stan Kroenke talk.
No, it was a quick story.
How much Jeff Fisher was a terrible story.
I mean, look, the expectations for yesterday's show were huge. They met expectations. And I think off the top, I mean, I know I wanted to get that in off the top, but let's just talk about how the show completely met our expectations. You know, a lot of us were a little bit worried that it might turn into a Chris Long interview for 3 hours, or it might be a situation where Chris kind of felt excluded from the other two. But it ended up turning into the three of them just being really cohesive and having a really fun show.
Yeah,
what do you guys think?
I think I thought about it a lot the day before, because it was one of those things where it was like the day before Christmas, where everyone was so amped for this. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, what are the steps we have to take to not screw this up, right? And the only concern that I had was that we wouldn't be streamlined enough to have a plan and it would just be random chatting mm-hmm. for 3 hours. And I think pre-show, we really made an effort to kind of slot certain segments in, but also keep it loose. Like I thought our plan was really well. And honestly, I don't think it could have gone any better. It was so great.
I know they had been texting about like stuff that they wanted to get done, which definitely was helpful. And I think a lot of the things, like we as like humans, like we think we want more until we've had too much and then we hate everything, right? So like for me, the 3 hour show with all three of them was perfect because it was like a little dose of everything. It like scratched all the itch, to use that, you know, phrase.
Gross.
And I think, and I think, like, if it, you know, if we had done this for a week, who knows? You guys might be like, this sucks. This is terrible. But for it being one day, 3 hour show, how Scott hadn't been there for like 2 years. It was obviously Chris's first time ever. It all came together, and I think it was balanced really well. And people seemed to really enjoy like the whole thing and all the bits, and even some of the serious stuff that we did with Chris.
Yeah, and it was great to get Chris's serious takes on Colin Kaepernick, on Kevin Durant. We obviously had the Bob Stoops Leaving Oklahoma news come down during the show. And I think that was one thing we definitely wanted to work in. Of course, we wanted to do the pulse and do these fun bits with him because he's such a fun guy like that. But to have an athlete who, especially an athlete who's been in a league for 10 years, get his perspective on some of the top sports stories that were going on, I thought was also really valuable.
I thought it was cool to do actual segments with Scott here again, too, because it was,
well, I want to ask
it
you
was
guys,
like a throwback.
I want to ask you, because you guys had never met him before, and obviously I worked with him for like the first whole year when I was basically in Tommy Freezepops' job on SVP and Russillo. Like, what was your thought on Scott?
He's tall.
He's very tall.
He is alarmingly tall. And obviously, again, I'd seen him in the hallways and stuff, and like, but being around that height for 3 hours makes you feel real small. He is tall. That is my biggest takeaway.
All right,
Freezepops. Really, really tall dude.
I, much like the show was really hyped, there was these really high expectations about how great the show was going to be. The same for me and meeting Scott. Everybody loves Scott. So your expectations are, wow, he's going to be a great guy. And you think, oh, yeah, I'm sure he's great, but he's probably not going to be that great. But he's that great. Like, he came right in, introduced himself to me. We chatted for a while. He's so down to earth and fun and funny. And I mean, I've only worked with him one time. Big fan.
It was interesting to see the chemistry between he and Ryen. Like, it was still there.
It was right away.
It didn't, you know, it was 2 years between the last time they'd really done shows together, and it was completely picked up like it was nothing.
Right. And when he first got here, and it was you and I in the control room because Michelle was off fangirling
talking
with
about
Chris Long.
Yeah.
Actually not. Talking so, Central West End bars. Miss St. Lunatics will know what that means.
When he got here, he was, you know, BSing with us in the control room a little bit. And then he came in here and he was testing his headphones and stuff. Ryen came into the studio and they immediately, like, they dapped it up. They were so pumped. And I'd say maybe 90 seconds later, they're like, all right, let's do a pulse. They wanted to just get right into it, and they were hot on it. And I was like, all right, do you want me to play the music? And Scott was like, yes, just hit the music when you're ready and I'll go.
Yeah. So let me take you behind on how that actually goes down. So they have, It's ad lib, but it's not. Like, they have points and things that they want to get to. Like, they know they want to, you know, Scott knew what he wanted to open with. Ryen had lines that he knew he wanted to get to. And it's all about, like, basically making it come together as one and sounding as natural as possible. So I'd say for that pulse, there was probably three or four takes, not fully, but like a parts of it that I will then edit together, bleep out, you know, the swears. And they were all, actually, Scott was the only one that sweared. Ryen didn't even swear. But
Ryen made one questionable word.
Yes.
We had a questionable phrase,
yeah.
We'll say.
Yep.
It wasn't a swear.
So we left that one out.
Yeah, we left that one out.
Use your imagination. So, but yeah, like, they basically do it, and, like, you know, as soon as they stop, they're like, okay, stop there, all right, we'll pick up from here, and Freeze Pops will stop the you know, shipping off to Boston, and then restart it again, and they'll just, like,
really,
redo
really
it again.
Fun to be part
and
of
it's
that.
It's almost, I mean, as you imagine, like, it's honestly funnier to listen to watch it live and see them do this live, because, like, they keep restarting and changing things,
right.
And it's just so funny to see that, to see how it goes
we
together.
We were dying.
I mean, Freeze Pops and I were crying
in the
control
room.
The
first take was amazing, because they had to stop because they just started cracking.
It was
up,
so
too.
Good. Yeah, like, you can't just do that voice for, you know, 2 minutes straight without absolutely laughing. And, like, they laugh in the middle of it, and then they'll reset, and it's funny, and then that's the magic of editing.
Yeah, it was fantastic. I was so happy they were able to do that.
Michelle in the background actually was really funny, because I was like, because I wanted to make sure that I didn't miss any swears, because Ray, who some of you SVP and Russillo fans used to know, was the old producer, and he used to have me listen to it and be like, hey, make sure I don't miss any swears, and, like, the audio sounds fine. So I had Michelle do that this time, and we're, like, in the middle of a segment.
Yeah,
she's listening
Michelle
to it, just cracking up in the background.
Right.
Because I had forgot that it was her first, that she wasn't in the studio
when
we recorded it.
Yeah, I was prepping with Chris before, so I didn't hear it. So when Ceruti asked me to listen to it, I genuinely had no idea
what was
coming.
What the hell
coming.
Is going on?
I was dying laughing. It was so funny. That's a segment I wish we would do more often. It was incredible.
So Chris killed it on those voicemails, too. Absolutely killed it. One take. We did it during a commercial break. We'll play them for you again here. We did two takes. We played both of them, but each were done in one take. He did fantastic.
Hello. No one is available to take your call. Please leave a message after the tone.
Hey, Tom. Chris Long here. I was on the Patriots Super Bowl championship team. Was also in the team photo. Pro Football Focus graded me out well in the Super Bowl. You might not remember my role playing. But anyways, I was going to see if you would come on the show today. The guys are kind of making me make this call. So I'm sorry to bother you. I know we hadn't talked in a while. I call every now and again. Anyways, give me a call back when you get a chance.
And here is the second one.
Hello. No one is available to take your call. Please leave a message after the tone.
Hey, Tommy. C-Long. I called Jules a couple times. He said he didn't know where you were right now. I'm not sure. You know, I'm not sure. Is this a business line? Because I call a lot. Anyways, Chris Long was on the team with you last year. Hope you're doing good. I was seeing if you... I'm a radio host today. I still play football, but I'm a radio host today, and I wanted to see if you'd come on. All right, thank you.
Spot on. That is exactly what we wanted.
So when he and Ryen and I were talking pre-show, we had kind of talked about this, but very briefly. He didn't write notes, really, on any of this, and just sat down. We said, okay, we're rolling. Go ahead and do it. And within one take, he nailed it. It was so funny. The cadence was perfect.
Yeah, I mean, he's a funny guy. The thing about Chris is, like, I like people like this. He has, like, a weird side to him. And I think every good human being has, like, a weird side to them. And, you know, when he was talking about, like, how he's really into the movie Drive, so he bought, like, a whatever Impala.
Yes.
Like
and the jacket.
Yeah,
too.
Like the jacket. Like, that's just awesome. And, like, he gets it. Like, he's funny. Like, he would. It's not like I'm going to tell you a joke funny, but, like, it was sarcastic. It was great. And obviously, like, he was kind of, like, weird now because people were like, oh, is that real, dude? That's lame. You're hitting up Brady on Twitter or on you know, trying to call him, blah, blah, blah.
He was getting so nervous,
like,
that people would think it's real.
Like,
because people did.
I'm amazed that people were like, oh, yeah, I can't believe Chris called. Like,
no, people
so
were like, dude,
I had
he's
buddies
at practice.
Text me.
Obviously, he didn't call Brady to see if he can come on.
Yeah. Like, I had two different guys text me asking if it was real.
That's unbelievable. Like, are we just, like, are we really, like, overestimating people's intelligence? I don't know. Like, who knows?
Well, and from a technical standpoint, if he did leave the message, that would be very difficult for us to
get. Like,
if Tom,
yeah.
You know what I mean? How
Brady
would we get
the
message?
Send us the audio?
Yeah.
Hey, Tommy.
Tom loves that.
That's
so that'll
such
be
a great drop.
Rotation. Good
I love
times.
That drop.
And you got to love someone like him, who's obviously this super successful athlete that comes in and is really down to do that and not take himself seriously.
Definitely.
Was there anything that you wish we had done yesterday that we didn't get to do as someone that worked on the show in the past, Ceruti?
A mailbag would have been pretty awesome. I know the old school fans would have loved a mailbag. Basically, if you don't know, it's when Scott and Ryen would basically sit in the studio after, and Ray and I would film on like a GoPro, like random email questions, and they were always like stupid but really funny. It was kind of
what
like...
What email account would they use?
It was probably like SVP and Russillo at ESPN.com, which is, don't try to email us. It doesn't... Well, maybe it works, but I'm not going to read any of them.
We also don't know the password.
I don't know. I might have access to it still. You know what? Do send us emails. I'll check it out. I'll look. But that would have been really cool because it's just like the best... You know what would have been actually really funny too would have been like they used to close the show with, I've got something to say, let me ask you a question, which is basically like one thing that they didn't get to, plus like random also questions from Twitter. Like that's when I think Scott and Ryen are at their best, is when like there's like random things thrown at them and they just like react ad-lib style to it because they have such great chemistry. And one of the things that's pretty incredible is like chemistry like that's really hard to find.
Super rare.
Like, it doesn't, and they didn't have it right away. It's not something that you just, like, overnight, oh, we have chemistry, cool. And so maybe sometimes it is, but, like, you have to work at it a lot. And I know they had done the show for, like, 5-6 years, and it took a few years for them to really get where they wanted to go. But the two of them together, I'm not sure there's ever anything funnier than, you know, on ESPN Radio that I've ever heard.
Now, and one thing they both did that I noticed was they both do that kind of, like, John Krasinski office, like, look back into the control room whenever something... They make one of those like little one-off comments, which is definitely funny to the listener. But then they also like kind of do the, you know, the office mockumentary style thing, and they kind of look over just like briefly, and it always gets me every single time.
There's so Dan
they
Stanzik.
They both were doing it.
Dan Stanzik, who I know listens to the pod and is one of the producers of Mike and Mike.
He's a cinephile.
He always. Oh, that's right. He also is a producer of Cinephile.
We don't need to plug Cinephile here.
Yeah, God, we know Adnan doesn't enough. He always like loves to say this thing like you are, I forget the exact wording of it, but it's like your personality is like basically you morph into the five people that you hang out with the most. And he loves like telling me that and basically how I've like somewhat morphed into Russillo. But there are a lot of things that I've taken from Scott as well from working on the show. Like he'll say like, oh, he refers to himself as your boy. And I do that a lot now.
You do that.
I'll be like,
oh
yeah, your boy said this, like, and I'm referring to myself. And Scott was the originator. He used to do that all the time. He used to refer to himself as your boy. And there are a lot of like weird little things like that, like looking in the control room or doing the office size John Krasinski thing that like I have now since adapted because it is so funny.
Yeah.
And like it just like works on the show, which I definitely missed. And it was funny to see Scott do that yesterday.
Yeah. And I love because they were both doing it too. It was great.
It was an incredible show. I honestly was so fired up to be a part of it because I know how much the listeners and viewers loved it. And everyone hates everything today. I mean, people are super negative, especially online. And the amount, just the sheer volume of people that reached out to tell us how much they loved yesterday was awesome. So thanks to everyone that listened or consumed it in some way. And thanks for tweeting us and letting us know how much you loved it.
Yeah, or all the new subscribers or anyone that just listened yesterday. Fantastic.
Also, I tweeted this yesterday, but if you loved it and you want to help us thank Chris Long, you could always head to waterboys.org, donate to his cause. I feel like we plugged it at the end of the show yesterday, but, you know, if you want to show your appreciation for him, it's always good to help him out, help out his great charity.
Yeah, it's incredible. I mean, honestly.
Yeah, that was kind of it got like super real for like 3 minutes when he was talking about it.
No, the stuff that organization does is amazing.
And, you know, he talked about it a little bit at the end of the show, but he's right. You know, going over there and seeing poverty at that level makes you super grateful for what you have here in America. So I was actually looking at the website because I went and donated, and you can donate anywhere from $8, I think, helps bring clean water to someone over there. And to think about that was literally our lunch today. It was $8. So every little bit helps.
Good stuff.
And maybe I'll do that instead of one of those little personal notes. You know, hey, I thought you did great in the Super Bowl. Here's $8.
There you go. I think he would appreciate that more, Tom.
I think he would, too.
I know. I think it's really cool that he has, like, this awesome worldview, too. Because a lot of athletes do a lot of awesome stuff domestically. And you don't really see a lot of American athletes kind of go outside those borders. I mean, a lot of baseball players will help out their hometowns in the Dominican and stuff like that. But I just feel like it's almost rare to see guys go out and do stuff in Africa like that. It's really, really cool to see that. All right, guys. Thanks again for listening to the post-show podcast. Big stuff on tap for next week's PSP. Right, Ceruti?
Yeah. So at lunch today, we were talking about Mean Girls for whatever reason. And I think next week we're going to decide which people on the show are which characters in Mean Girls. I think I'm the front runner for Regina George.
People are going to think I'm Regina George, but little do they know that it's sneaky Ceruti.
Find out next week.
Tune in.
Thanks for listening to the Ryen Russillo Show post-show podcast. Be sure to subscribe on the Listen tab of the ESPN app and tune in to the Ryen Russillo Show weekdays at 1 Eastern on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
And now, insurance-minded speeches from GEICO.
Hardship. My grandmother would go through it every month to pay her insurance bill. First, she would handwrite a paper check in cursive. Then, using her own tongue, she would wet a stamp for an envelope. Today, however, we need not weary our hands and tongues. Today, we can pay our GEICO bill with the GEICO app. Away with hardship, in with bill pay on the GEICO app. Thank you.